I'm skipping around a little bit in reading tonight. 1 Kings 18:21. And Elijah came unto all the people and said, How long halt ye between two opinions? If the Lord be God, follow him. But if Baal, then follow him. And the people answered him, Not a word. They didn't have any answer to give. No answer. In the 30th verse of that same chapter, And Elijah said unto all the people, Come near unto me. And all the people came near unto him, and he repaired the altar of the Lord that was broken down. And Elijah took 12 stones, according to the number of the tribes of the sons of Jacob, unto whom the word of the Lord came, saying, Israel shall be thy name. And with the stones he built an altar in the name of the Lord. Verse 37, I'm breaking in on his prayer. Hear me, O Lord, hear me, that this people may know that thou art the Lord God, and that thou hast turned their heart back again. Then the fire of the Lord fell and consumed the burnt sacrifice and the wood and the stones and the dust and licked up the water that was in the trench. And when all the people saw it, they fell on their faces and they said, The Lord, He is the God. The Lord, He is the God. Turn with me into the 13th chapter of the book of Revelations tonight. To bring this down to what you and I may be facing. I'm lifting thee from the 16th verse on, chapter 13. Revelations chapter 13, 16. And he causeth all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their foreheads. And that no man might buy or sell, save he that had the mark or the name of the beast. Or the number of his name. Here is wisdom. Hath understanding count the number of the beast, for it is the number of the man, and his number is 666. May we bow our heads in prayer, please. Brother Benninger, stand and pray for me, please. To continue in the theme of the ministerial, I'd like to think with you tonight on the tragedy of a neglected harvest. The tragedy of a neglected harvest. How shall you escape if you neglect so great salvation? How shall you escape what? The damnation of hell. If we neglect this great salvation that God has provided for us and trample underfoot the blood of the Son of God and disregard and disrespect His commandments and go on our way and live as we please, there's going to come a day when God is going to make us give an account for every deed done in the body. I was thinking of Masterson, the great saint of yesterday, one night when he was praying and he was thinking of all of the things that we've perhaps been thinking of during this ministerial. And in the zeal of his heart, he cried out, Oh God, stamp the word eternity on each of my eyeballs. And let me look out at this world and everything of this world through that one word, eternity. Eternity. Stamp it on each of my eyeballs, and I'll never get away from it, that I'll not get enraptured to the things of this old life and this old world. Breaking this down, I'm dealing with three thoughts here tonight, maybe breaking them down on different headings. The first thought I want to bring with you is the word materialism. Materialism. The second thought that this text brings to us is the word rationalism. And the third thought it brings to us is the word collectivism. Those are very popular and yet common terms, and you might think, well, why would Brother Kendall mention something like that? Because it's desperately important in this day. We're caught in this thing. We're enamored with this. We're enmeshed in this. We're entangled in this. It's got more of a grip upon us than what we want to admit. Amen. How careful we need to be as we face this thing. The deplorable condition that they were in back in those days. They trampled underfoot the Son of God. They forgot all about the great heritage that they had. They forgot all of the inheritance that God had provided for them and the great land that God had given them, and they became materialistic minded. Now there's two or three things that I want to try to get settled here in the beginning. The first thing This word materialism means that everything is matter and nothing is spirit. That's what the basis of materialism is. Just all is matter. There's no spiritual life to it. And you're getting it from your schoolrooms, you're getting it from your church pulpits, you're getting it from the congressional halls of Washington, you're getting it from your state halls, I'm sure, and halls right here in this own state, and we are in Alabama. It's all materialism, materialism. Now, when the spirit of the world and the spirit of materialism gets a hold of us and begins to grip our mind, as a man thinketh in his heart, the Bible says, so is he. And we have a brainwashing process going on that we need to be very careful of in this day. Higher pay, shorter hours, more time for fun, more time for pleasure, more time to race and run, eat, drink, and be merry. You're just a higher species of an animal. When you die, that's all of it. I don't believe that.
Amen.
God created man in his own image and after his own likeness. And man has certain capabilities and certain qualities that the highest and most intelligent beast does not have. And there's no way for scientism or pseudoscience or anything else to link them together. It's an impossibility.
Amen.
It's an impossibility. God created man as the capstone of his creation and gave him a spiritual quality and gave him a spiritual dome that looks toward heaven and placed within him that which can commune with God and fellowship with God and harmonize with God. And that's what this great and glorious redemption is as we look upon it. This was a land of drought that we're dealing with here tonight. There was no rain for the period of 3.5 years. Can you imagine not a drop of dew nor a drop of rain, any moisture fall at all for 3.5 years? It was a dying nation. They were dying, looking at each other and watching for them to die. It reminds me of in the history books where we studied about the Spanish wars there in Cuba when they were fighting for their life, and one of the families that was so prominent in that, and he took his family out, his children and his wife out into the woods as far as he could and hid them away, and then he'd go back and fight every day. And that went on for months and months and months. He began to bury them, and he buried one after one, and finally his oldest daughter and himself was the only two that was left. And he said, I'm going to go to war today. You take care of the things here and stay close into the little shelter that we have. And she said, but Daddy, we buried Mother, we buried all the other four children, and you and I are the only ones left. What are you going to do? He said, I'm going to fight till probably you die. And I picked out the place to bury you yesterday when I buried your baby brother. And I'll bury you there. And then I'll go back and I'll fight. And I'll fight for the freedom of the nation and for the cause of liberty. I'll fight till I die. And then wherever they bury me, it doesn't make any difference. A dying nation. We don't look at people as though they were dying souls. We don't look at people like that. We look at them and we categorize them by their color, their description, or their size, or what it might be. We don't look at them as a dying individual. When I see those teeming masses up and down those airport corridors and I look at them, I think I said to somebody just the other day, I said, you could walk out here and stop any of these thousands of people that's milling up and down these corridors. You could say to them, where are you really going? And they'd tell you, oh, Philadelphia, New York, Hawaii, or London, or Paris, or someplace else. I doubt if it would be one out of all the teeming thousand that would say to you, sir, I'm headed for eternity. I'm headed for eternity. I'm passing by the way this place here, Indiana, PA, I'm passing by and making a few stops here and there. But really where I'm headed for is eternity. A dying nation as they looked upon it. Now you can look upon it from the physical standpoint if you want to. 3.5 years of drought. But I want to look at it momentarily here from the spiritual standpoint. 3.5 years. No revival in your church. No revival. No real revival in your home. No revival in your own heart. Wonder how many of us tonight would dare say, I have a continuous revival going on in my heart. The Spirit of the living God, the anointing of God, the blessing of God, the presence of God, the communion of God, the riches of His grace, thank God, the walking and talking and communing with Him until there's a constant, continuous Holy Ghost revival going on in my heart. Thank God. Spiritual revival. I've asked this question across the country. I don't want anybody to lift their hands here tonight. But I said, all you young people under 35 years of age tonight, how many of you have ever seen and ever participated in a real, true Holy Ghost revival? 35 years and under, you've really seen. You've seen the demonstration. You felt the mighty effects. You've seen the fruit of the thing. You recognize this. You've seen real, true Holy Ghost revival. And not only changed the church, but it changed the face of the community. It cleaned the thing up and cleaned her out and cleaned a whole avenue out of there. Holy Ghost revival. You know what we're doing? We're saying we're going to have revival. From such and such a time in April to such and such a day in April. Or we're going to have revival in May or June. And our young people have looked at this until they don't hardly believe and have no confidence that there's such a thing as revival. How careful we need to be that we're living in a land of spiritual drought. There's just no revivals flowing. It's just not coming. There's very few churches that are producing revival. I remember dear Brother Fawcett. You folks remember him well, I'm sure most of you. When I went out in the field back in 1954, he'd been out a number of years. He put his arm around me and he said, "Well, Brother Kendall," he said, "it's going to be new and it's going to be different." That's what the Nevilles will find too. He said, "But you ought to have on an average of 22 to 23 revivals a year. Have just a little time for rest." And he said, "Out of those 22 or 23 revivals, you'll have 18 or 19 real breakthrough in Holy Ghost revival." Can you imagine in 35 years, 34 years, he put his arm around me as I walked out of the platform in Hope Sound Camp in 1976. He was gone before we started in 77. He put his arm around me and he said, "Brother Kendall, remember what I said to you when you went out in the field in 54? I said, "Maybe not just exactly." He said, "I was talking to you about the number of revivals to hold and how many would probably break through and give you a real Holy Ghost revival." I said, "Yes, I do, Brother Fawcett." He said, "Let me tell you something today. You'd be fortunate if you hold 22 or 23 revivals if you had one or two breakthrough." Can you imagine? But we're self-satisfied. We're self-contented. We're self-pleased. A better job, a better money, Social Security. We have the benefits coming in for. We're protected by insurance and we're protected by all of this. We're settled there. We hardly recognize that materialism has got such a grip upon us. And here we are contented. Contented to go on and just let them race on their way and enjoy life. And it doesn't make any difference whether we have revival or whether we don't have revival. It doesn't make any difference at all. Oh, my. Reese Howes, when they were bombing England, and it just looked like the old Messerschmitts and all those of the German force and all the Air Force was going to blow England off the map and was going to take that thing. Reese Howes, that great man, if you haven't read his book, you ought to read it. Reese Howes, Intercessor. Intercessor. He walked out and called the people to prayer and began to pray. They began to fast and pray. They held on to God in prayer. And I want to say to you that prayer touches the heart of God and prayer reaches the throne of heaven and real true intercessory prayer moves the heart of God. Amen. With 240-some thousand or 50-some thousand soldiers, British soldiers there at Dunkirk, and it looked like they were just going to be swamped away and carried into captivity or killed or massacred. And Reese Howell and that crowd began to pray. And God sent a fog over that old English Channel, and God sent the clouds across the sky, and that old English Channel, if you've ever been across there, how rough she is and how wild she is, that thing become like a little pond. There was not a wave, and they rolled across that thing and delivered the whole British army out from Dunkirk and brought it back. Oh, if we could come to our senses and realize and wake up to the realization we're facing a spiritual drought. We're in desperate conditions. I remember one church I was in shortly after the Second World War. One of the men said to me, he said, "Brother Kendall, we had 66 young men in the Second World War from this church. 66 young men. Said there wasn't but one of them that was injured slightly in the war. Not a one of them were lost. All 66 of them came back. But he said, you see that altar? He said, from the time that those boys began to leave and the first one sailed, that altar was never barren of somebody praying. In the daytime, the mothers and the women and the young women kept that altar going and that prayer going. And then on Friday night when the men were clear and free, they prayed on Friday and Friday night and Saturday night and Sunday and Sunday night. 66 boys over there, but the prayers of that praying church brought them back.
But hear me, let me go one step farther. But he said tonight, Brother Kendall, I don't know if we could get anybody to stay for all night of prayer. Brother, can't we see, if we could see the dangers of boys in war and shrapnel and shell and cannon and dive bombing and everything else, if we could see it, it looks like we could see the awfulness of a lost soul plunging into eternity without a ray of hope.
Lord, help.
A drought. We're living in that drought. We're living in that drought. Oh, you'd know this man if I would call him by name. Preaching with him in the Penns Creek camp a number of years ago, he gave me this illustration. I believe it was he here, one of the family. He said, I was a wayward boy. My father was just a common tenant farmer. And he said it was late in the spring. The ground was getting tough and weeds were getting high. And I was plying with a mule team. We didn't have tractors in those days. And he said, God spoke to my dad and said, if you'll unhitch the team and turn them out in the pasture and go to your place of prayer, I'll give you Gene, your oldest boy, wayward and lost and wicked and vile and far from God. He said, my dad didn't hesitate. He didn't think about what the farmer was going to say and the landlord was going to say and how much tougher it'd get or how long he might have to pray. He just unhitched that team, drove them to the barn, unharnessed them, and turned them out in the pasture. I'm here to settle this thing. Friends, we just do not have very many intercessors today. You can say what you want to. There's plenty of room for intercessors today.
Amen.
Let me ask you right straight out. Do you know anything about the prayer of intercession? Do you know anything about being an intercessor? Do you know anything about God trusting you and God trusting me and laying upon the soul? Oh. You say, what would the compassion have been? I want to say to you that the Spirit of God leads us in intercessory prayer. And when you and I don't know anything about intercessory prayer, if we'd search our hearts quite closely, we'd probably find we've got a grieved Holy Ghost on our hand because He can't trust us. We're so wrapped up in money, we're so wrapped up in gadgets, we're so wrapped up in playing golf, we're so wrapped up in all the playthings of this old world, we're so wrapped up in all the modern conveniences and the latest styles and the latest fashions and the latest drapes and the latest paint, and we got to change the thing all over. Every so many years, you know, you've got to renew the thing. God pity you pastors if you have to have a parsonage renewed and everything and let the church pay it out just to have it to please you or to please your wife. He said, my dad went to the house and put his arm around Mom. And she said, Daddy, what are you doing in? Well, the landlord will be sending, moving us off of this farm. She said, you know how tough the ground is getting and how late it's getting. It'll be late for the crops. What are you doing? He said, God spoke to me and told me to unhitch the mules and turn them loose in the pasture and go to my place of prayer. And he'd bring Gene into the fold. And he said, that's what I'm here for, Mom. She let him have a good tongue lashing. She was far from being a Christian. He said, Mom, if I'm not down for the noon meal, go on eat. And he said, if I'm not down for the evening meal, go on eat. And you and the boys take care of the crops, the cattle, and take care of the chores. She said, through that day, not for noon, not for the evening meal. No, sir. We'd rather eat today than we would to see souls saved. She said, about 11 o'clock, I heard somebody hit that back door. He slammed that door shut as he came in, rushed into our bedroom and snapped the light on and said, where's Dad? She said, he's upstairs praying. He said, I know what he's praying for too. He's praying for me. She said, I heard him take those steps two and three at a time. Went into the closet where he prayed, threw his arms around him and said, Dad, pray for me. I felt like I was dropping into hell. I couldn't enjoy anything of this old world. I felt like I was dropping into hell, and if it didn't stop me, it was your prayers. What if that daddy would have said, I'm too busy? What if he said, I'm going to work overtime? What if he said, I'm going to do this? What if he'd have sold out for the dollar? Gene would have probably split hell wide open instead of being a preacher out there in the church of where he was preaching with us there in Old Penns Creek camp. Oh, we're living in a day when we can hardly recognize it seems like a spiritual drought. We don't hardly realize what it was. They was in a desperate condition, a deplorable condition as they looked upon this. But I want you to see the second thing. They were a delinquent nation. They were a delinquent nation. A delinquent means they're not living up to their responsibility. They're not living up to the duties and obligations that are theirs to take care of. That goes for us pastors and us evangelists. That goes for the layman of the church and every board member of the church and every official of the church and our conference officials and our connectional officials. Living up to the duty and the obligations and the responsibility that they have taken and has been placed upon them, and to do what's right and best and what's needful to do to see a Holy Ghost revival come. We're a delinquent nation tonight, far from God. Oh, our fast-speeding cars on the highways, 60,000 deaths, the last report we had in the year. 60,000 deaths and 278,000 maimed bodies that will be maimed for life on the highways. But who cares? What difference does it make? What does it matter? Doesn't make any difference. We're a delinquent nation. We're far from being awake to the fact of what it is and what we're facing. Think of the awful thing of alcoholics. 91, I believe I'm right on this, 91 million alcoholics in America. And a third of them are women. And alcoholism is growing 25% faster among our women than it is among our men. Can you imagine such a thing? In a letter some time back, a boy wrote to me that had prayed through. He said, "Brother Kendall, this is kind of asking a lot of you," but he said, "would you know that my mother in such and such a city?" And then he went on to tell me, he said, "she's an alcoholic, Brother Kendall. She's in jail there for the crime that she's committed. My mother, there." But what does it matter? Well, we go in and out of the supermarkets, we go in and out of the malls, we go out, and it never bothers us. With a six-pack of beer and everything, and with a carton of cigarettes there, and with cursing and swearing and telling dirty jokes and everything, it never bothers us. How long has it been since you've come home with tears streaming down your face? How long have you come home till your heart was broken and you felt crushed as you thought, "Oh, what I've seen, a little baby in one of those cars and a pack of cigarettes or a carton of cigarettes and a six-pack of beer there, and here's a mother smoking one, and here she was cursing and carrying on. You never gave her a tract. You never spoke to her. You never asked her about her soul. You never said a thing to her. We're a delinquent nation. We don't care. Let them go on to hell. It don't make any difference. We just look upon them as though they were some other animal." How long has it been since you've been out on the street and some older lady maybe passes you and the snuff juice is running down her chin, and here she is and she's mumbling to herself, and you slip up by the side of her and say, "Sister, I'm a stranger and you're a stranger to me, but I'm a pastor of such and such a church, or I'm an evangelist or a church member. I just wondered, do you know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior? Have you ever really been born in the Spirit of God? If it become your time to die unexpectedly, would you really be ready to meet Him?" Maybe it's an old gentleman cursing and swearing, sucking out an old pipe or an old stogie or something else. Are you concerned and interested enough? You mean to tell me you're a Christian? You mean to tell me you're a professed Christian? You mean to tell me you're a church member and a Sunday school teacher and hold an office in the churches, and you're not interested in a lost and dying world all about you? We're a delinquent nation. The responsibility. You're the salt of the earth. And if the salt has lost its savor, where shall it be? It's as fit for nothing to be cast out and trodden under foot of man. You're the light of the world. Oh, my. No wonder we're in the condition we're in. No wonder we're there. No wonder we're there. As we look upon it. What is it? Say we spend for gambling in America today? $200 and some billion spent in gambling today. Oh. 140 some million, I believe it is, there for cigarettes, and 191 or 92 billion spent upon alcoholic beverages and liquor. We're a drunken nation today. We're a nation of drunkards. Our vomit is upon our tables, and our filth and our slime and our breath upon those as we look upon this. 2 million babies about killed by abortion year after year. Killing for money. I was in a meeting not too long ago. A lady was seeking at an altar prayer. She just couldn't get any place. She just couldn't seem to get any place. At the close of that altar service, when everyone else had gone, one of the gentlemen of the church stayed. He said, "Brother Kendall, she's got something she's facing. Something she's really facing." I said, "I'm sure she does have." He said, "Let me tell you, maybe you'll know how to pray for her. She tried her best to hire two young men of the town here to dispose of her husband. She wanted to marry somebody else. Killing for money, killing for pleasure, killing for a thrill, killing to get rid. I don't want a child. I don't want to be a mother. I don't want to be a father. I don't want the responsibility. My, I would that the younger women marry, be keepers at home, and bear children. My, you better give some consideration to the sacred vows that you take and to this great word of God when you look upon us. We're a delinquent nation today. We don't want to face up to God's eternal word of truth. We just do not want to face up to it. We're living in a day, my, when it seems like we've forgotten everything that was ever handed down to us. The altar of remembrance. Why, what an altar if we stop and analyze and think and call back a remembrance of what a heritage we have. Israel doesn't have any greater heritage than what we have. Not any greater heritage. When you stop to think of Sinai and you think of Calvary and you think of Pentecost and you think of the apostles and you think of the martyrs and then you come on down to our old nation and you think of the pilgrim fathers over here and you think of Columbus and those few continental soldiers bleeding and frostbitten feet, and here they are fighting for our freedom and for our independence and deliverance from the tyranny there of England. You think of all of this, but here we are. We just seem to have forgotten the altar of remembrance as we look upon it and face it there and see what it is as we look upon. It was a dare. Not only were they a desperate and a deplorable condition and place, but they were a delinquent people. I want you to see that. I wish I had an illustration that could take this truth home to me right quick, but I don't. So we'll just pass right on. They were in not only that condition, but they were a derelict people. A derelict. They didn't seem to have conscience and mind and sane enough thinking to get themselves straightened out for the condition they were in. They were a derelict people. They'd turned aside from the fountains of living waters and hewed them out cisterns, broken cisterns that could hold the water. When God and those old prophets and preachers turned to them and said, "Stand ye in the past and ask for the old path, where's the good way?" They said, "We will not." And they stoned the prophets and they murdered them and they turned aside and laughed and scorned and went on their merry way as though it was nothing. What was it was called? I go right back to it. It was materialism. They were wrapped up in the things of this old life. They were wrapped up in pleasure. The pleasure God, the prosperity God, oh my, and the popularity God. People are selling out today for those three gods today.
Oh, yes.
The pleasure God, the prosperity God, and the popularity God. As one lady said some time back, she said, "I hear the miniskirts are coming back." She said, "I hate those things. I hate those things." Well, I'm glad she did. But she said, "I'm not going to be different. And I just think of how long it's going to take me to take up all my skirts and make miniskirts out of them." Oh, I don't want to be different. I don't want my children to be different. I want them to be in the who's who. I want them to rank out there with the crowd. I want them to be popular. I'm afraid they'll be set aside. They just won't be popular, and they won't gain the popularity and the praise that they need to at school. I want to be popular. What's he saying? He's saying the same as one dear mother, and I kind of hold back to mention it here, but a mixed congregation. She said to her daughter, when she was going away to be a freshman in college, she talked to her about other things, and then she said, "And I want to talk to you about your own individual moral life." You'd have thought she'd have gave her some good instructions and given her the instructions. She said, "I want to tell you how to keep from having a childbirth. We've gone a million miles from purity and morals and moral stature and moral cleanness. We're living in the day. This thing has gradually brainwashed us and come upon us and tell you, there you are with your co-ed education there in the colleges, and there you are with your co-ed living there in the dormitories, boys and girls together. There you are with our women in the armed service, and what is it? Even 11% or 14% of them come out there as unwed pregnant mothers. There they come. There they come. And yet we just sit back and as though it's nothing to it. A derelict nation that doesn't seem to have sense enough to realize the condition we're in and the way that we're going and the things that we're having is we're faced up to the thing. We find a desperate prophet of God what a desperate prophet he was as he was trying to awaken that desperate, deplorable, derelict, delinquent nation to the realization of what they were. And he called them, and the first question he asked them, why halt ye between two opinions? Why halt ye between two opinions? I don't know of any other answer for it unless it would be rationalism. Nothing is absolutely right and nothing is absolutely wrong. There's no absolute truth. There's no absolute God. There's no absolute Bible. There's no absolute judgment. There's nothing absolute about eternity. Everything is rationalized and just brought down to where there we are and there we stand tonight as we face this thing. And that's where we are today. I don't see things as I used to. I'm sure you don't. I'm sure you don't. I don't see things like Mom and Dad did. I just don't see them like that. They've rationalized this thing and brought it down until there is no standard to the thing. Yes, sir. And we bring it into the church. Here's the church. My, they just don't see it. We just don't see it in this church where we're worshiping, and I'm thankful for the privilege to be here to have the night services. But just think of the founder, John Wesley. Just think of it. Think of those great old bishops and think of those great old saints of God that blazed the trail and pioneered Methodism across America. And think of those that pioneered the Nazarene and the Pilgrims, and think of those who pioneered our own Allegheny Conference. Does it bother you at all? Does it bother you at all to face this thing, a desperate? He looked upon this thing in the desperation of what it was. I'm amazed. What do you think? Brother Van Warmer, the last time he talked to me, he said, Brother Kendall, it used to be you could come out here to old Stoneboro camp during the camp meeting or during the conference, and you could hardly come to the old prayer rock and find that somebody wasn't there praying. But then he looked at me and he said, but Brother Kendall, it's seldom you find anybody praying there anymore. It's seldom anybody ever goes there to visit. We see things different. Well, that's just foolishness. We'll run down and get us something to eat at the Dairy Queen. We'll run here, we'll run there. We'll show our slides over in our cottage, or we'll do something else, or we'll go hiking, or we'll go picnicking, or we'll go jogging, or something else. Our health is way more important. Our good health and our carrying out our program is way more important than seeing God break through in a camp. God break through and give us a real outpouring of the Spirit. What's it going to mean when some of our churches in the Allegheny Conference, they padlock the doors and they nail the windows and board them up? There's no preacher that wants to go there. There's no preacher that accepts it. There's no congregation left. And padlock it and lock them up and board up the windows and the church is closed. But we got a bunch of people right now that won't pray, they won't fast. And we got young people that won't take a rundown church. We got those that won't have a missionary spirit. We've got those that's got to be paid high and they've got to have a good salary. They've got to be entertained. They've got to have their comforts of life. They just won't do. What's it going to do? Does it bother you to think that we're going to see churches padlocked and we're going to see the windows boarded up because there's nobody attending and there's no preacher to go? I remember one of our conferences when a young couple came in before the committee there and they said, we don't have much left. He said, it doesn't matter what you have much left or not. He said, God's already appointed us to the place we're to go. Well, he said, where are you supposed to go? And he named a little rundown church. And the chairman of that committee said, son, you don't want to go there and take your wife there. There's only one member left, and a lot of times he's unable to come. He said, but sir, I have no choice in this. God has laid that church on our heart. And under God, I have an appointment to go to that little rundown church. And they couldn't change him. There was no changing him. And they assigned it to him. Let me digress here for a moment. I'll come back and pick it up. I remember another assignment. Some years ago, when they was changing some of the larger churches at the conference, and it was pretty well pictured out who was going here and who was going there and someplace else. And finally, the people there at the conference said, we'll see how he gets along there when he goes to Old Grace Church. We'll see how things go there. And that morning when they read the assignment and the appointments, when they read his name to the Grace Church, he stood with his head bowed and tears running down his face. He said, brethren, sisters of the conference, and friends and those who are here, I want you to know I've entered into a covenant with God. We'll either have revival in Old Grace Church or there'll be a funeral out of the parsonage. We'll either have a revival
I'm not interested in golf, nor peewee golf, nor bowling teams, nor skating rink parties. I'm not interested in hay rides and contests and picnics and puppet shows. I'm not interested in entertainment. There'll either be a revival in Old Grace Church or there'll be a funeral in the parsonage. We just don't see it. It just don't seem to penetrate the deep of our heart. What's fallen into our hands is our great inheritance and laid there. I wept the other day, Brother Manners, coming into South Carolina, camp where I preached, people that I know well, and there I was, closed, sold out and boarded up. Some kind of machinery in that there, it was gone. It was gone. Gone. I think of a camp where I've been in the South. Down there, they told me we had to sell the campground. We just don't have enough support. I said, who'd you sell it to? Oh, they said we sold it, and they called off the name. Said they're going to put a skating rink in where the dining hall was. They're going to have square dancing over here in one of the other buildings. And they went on the name. And my heart ached as I thought, oh, God, the saints that have prayed, the souls that have prayed through, the men that have preached and labored and poured out their heart there. And here's this generation that's turned aside the materialism and rationalism and don't matter, and they can just sell it off and laugh it off. It doesn't make one bit of difference to them. I was struck forcefully here some time back when they told me of a certain individual who'd climbed to Connectional Leadership in his conference there. And they said, Brother Kendall, two of the small churches, and they named them off, said they just feel like it's a liability to keep them. And he said he took his Connectional board out and had them de-dedicate. Did you ever hear such a thing? Had them de-dedicate those two churches so they could sell them out to nightclubs and sell them out to liquor joints. A desperate prophet that saw this thing and weighed this thing and felt this thing and was laid upon his heart. And here he was pouring out his heart, trying his best to stop that people and bring them back to their senses. Thank God. Oh, thank God for the fire of the Lord that falls, praise God, in a few places. And we're thankful for that. I remember in old Iowa, South Carolina, a few years back, when God got to Iowa, South Carolina, and he really came in mighty power. The morning service, one of them, you have morning services and night services there in those mill towns because of the three different shifts at work. And in that morning service, that lady came out, made her way out. She said, I'm president of the Missionary Society. I teach one of the classes here. But she said, I'm a backslidden lady. I love the world. I love the things of the world. I love the latest styles and the latest fashions. I love to keep up with the world. I love to be in the society crowd. I want the church to forgive me. I'm sorry, but I've been professing and putting on. I want God to forgive me. About 2 days later now, in the night service, the class leader stood up clear in the back of the church, and he said, Brother Kendall, there's no need to preach anymore. I'm the class leader of this church, but I'm backslidden. I've got wrapped up in politics, and I've been doing this, and I've been doing that, and I've done some underhanded things and sneaky things, and I failed God, and I let him down. I want the church to forgive me. On Sunday morning, God moved in on old Iowa, South Carolina, and Sunday morning that place was filled, and the vestibule was filled, and they were sitting outside on the fenders of the car. I don't remember even what we preached on that morning, but God took that service into his own hands. He brought that thing down and melted that crowd until the altar was filled. It was an altar in the back of the church, and it was an altar outside. One of them came in and pulled on the coattail of the pastor and said, Preacher, tell Brother Kendall there's no need to keep on the altar call. There's not a backslider. There's not an unsaved person. There's not an unsanctified person on these grounds or in this house that's not on her knees praying someplace this morning. Oh, thank God, thank God. When God comes, if we'd see it, if we'd get so hungry for it and long for it, thank God. But we're so touchy and we're so ouchy and we're so afraid somebody's going to take an advantage of us and we're going to lose out and we're not going to gain. I remember one lady screaming out at an altar prayer. She let out the most unearthly scream. Everybody stopped praying. In a little while she bowed her head and started praying again. She let out another scream like that and was silenced over that whole church. She prayed a little while longer and then there was silence again. She did that 5 different times. After she got through, prayed and testified, she said, I believe I owe the church and the people here tonight an apology. How I screamed out here. But she said, when God showed me the depth of carnality in my heart, the pride, the lust,
the desire for the things of this world, the nagging spirit that I had, the long gossiping tongue that I, when God showed me, she said I couldn't help but scream out when he'd show me that was in my heart, and I was a partaker of that. She said, and I don't want to stop just with that, but I want to confess on myself. She said, my husband used to be superintendent of the Sunday school here, Brother Kendall. I drove him out of the Sunday school and drove him out of the superintendency. I drove him out there to the backside. I never was satisfied. I always wanted something else. I was always nagging. I was always finding fault. I was critical. I just kept going and kept going until my husband finally threw up his hands and said, there's nothing to it, away with it. Oh, God, help us tonight to realize and recognize the fact we need to see ourselves and recognize where we are in this. Where we stand in this thing. But you say, Brother Kendall, if we take the desperate way, if we take this old rugged way, people would take advantage of us, and if we'd be humble and we'd be low, we'd be loving and compassionate and giving, and if we'd line up to the Sermon on the Mount, and if we'd line up to the 24th Psalm, if we'd line up to 1 Corinthians, what do you think they're in there for?
Amen. Amen.
Blessed are the poor in spirit, not the mighty and the wise and the great and the brilliant and
Amen.
The powerful.
Amen. Right.
Theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
Amen.
Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are they that hunger and thirst after righteousness. What you're hungering and thirsting after tonight? What Stanley Kendall's hungering and thirsting after? What are we really hungering for and thirsting after and striving for and laying out our hand? Oh, I'd just like to drive three thoughts home on that thought tonight. How much are you making an investment in the kingdom of God? How much are you investing in it?
Amen.
Lay not up for yourself treasures on earth, where thieves break through and steal, moth and rust and canker doth corrupt, but lay up for yourself treasures in heaven. Where tonight, pastor, where tonight, layman, would you say the greatest treasures are? Where tonight would you say your heart is and you're wrapped up in, and here you are out, every place you can get, try to make a little buy and buy something cheap and sell it high. Oh, an investment in the kingdom of heaven. What an investment that I have a spiritual home, a deep spiritual home life. Not just a nominal home life, but a deep spiritual home life. An investment in our Bible school, an investment in our conference here, our investment in our church where we are, an investment there. That's the greatest investment. It's not out here with bonds and securities and indemnities and all these other things that we accumulate and call up every week or so and find out, what's your interest rate? How much you paying? What's the greatest thing? Where can I make the most? Oh, how careful we ought to be where our investments are as we look upon this thing and face this thing and realize what it is and what we face in this thing. Oh, thank God, thank God. Let me illustrate what I mean by making an investment in this. I was preaching out in the West some years back. They gave me this illustration. They said the family, and they pointed out the family, said a mother, well, I believe it's either 5 or 6 children, and I recognized that, and I looked upon it, and they said, she's paid a great price. She's made an investment in the kingdom of God like very few people have ever made. And I said, she seems to be a very conscientious and a godly woman. Said her husband run off with another woman and left her with those 5 children and left her with a debt on her little home. That woman took that husband away from her. They went along and he finally got a divorce and married this other woman. Said she took those children around her when he left and they knew she was gone. And they said she took them and said, now that's your daddy. That's your daddy. He'll always be your daddy. Regard him and respect him, even though he's done wrong. Don't you let any bitterness nor any hatred get in your heart. Don't you let any revenge get in there. Don't you dare do it. There's an investment we've got to make, an investment of our soul in the very things of God. He said they went on, Brother Kendall, I guess for 21 or 22 years. That woman would ride by and make fun and laugh and poke and ridicule those children and laugh at them, and they'd drive a nice car and they had a nice home, and here they were barely eking out an existence, paying the bills and putting the children through school. And then one day one of the neighbors said to her, did you know your husband is dying of cancer and that his wife has cancer? And she said, I hadn't heard it. That's my husband, the one that I entered into those sacred marriage vows at an altar of prayer. She said, I began to pray, and I brought the children around me, and I said, children, your daddy's dying of cancer.
And the woman, even though she broke up her home, and even though she robbed you of your daddy and robbed me of my husband, even though she did it all, we have an obligation. Love your enemies. Do good to them who persecute you. If they can ask you to go a mile, compel them to go a mile, go the second mile. Said, we sat there and we talked about this, and they said, well, Mom, we can shift in our rooms, and us girls can go together, and the boys can go together, and we can find a room and prepare for them. And that's exactly what they did. They brought that poor, sick, dying man and woman into that home, fed them and clothed them, took care of them, washed them and bathed them, paid their doctor bills and took care of them, and stood there at their altar. I mean, at the graveside, they said, Brother Kendall, they stood there and shouted the praises of God that Daddy had made it in. Daddy had made it in. What kind of investment are you and I making? When we're so sheltered and so shielded and so shut up and so careful of ourselves, we'd be afraid it's going to cost us a dollar or going to cost us a penny or it was going to be a little extra hardship or a little extra task. Oh, and said, then the woman lived on for a while, and they loved and cared and nourished and ministered to her and led her to God. Thank God, and shouted at her grave at this woman that had even broken up their home and made it through. What kind of an investment am I making in my foes, the ones that hate me and despise me? What kind of an influence am I wielding upon people? What kind of an influence? I don't know how it does with you, but it staggers me to think of my influence. The influence of every word that I speak. The influence of every act that I commit. Of every step that I take. Of every action that I partake of. An unseen and unrecognized and unknown thing called influence, as it reaches out to a lost and a dying world and to people all about us. That influence, how careful I need to be. For God's keeping a record of it, and the recording angel is writing it down, everything there is about it. How careful I need to be with my influence. Oh, wonderful, wonderful, wonderful Jesus. I remember a lady praying through one of the tent meetings. Didn't know a thing about salvation. She'd come in the second week, got in line, went to an altar prayer, prayed through, stripped herself of all her flubdubbery and all of her jewelry, wiped the makeup from her face, cleaned out her purse, emptied it out, and prayed until she repented to the bottom and prayed through. She went home, looked that husband in the face, and he said, where have you been? She said, I stopped by the tent meeting tonight. She said, God got a hold of my heart. She said, I hadn't told you before, but this is the third night I've been there. And said, husband, God did something in my heart. I don't ever want to lose the peace, the joy, the happiness he's brought to me.
Amen.
He said, well, I guess it's all right. But he said, don't try to poke your religion off on me. And then he looked and saw her rings was gone. And he said, where are your rings? Well, she said, I took them off. I don't need any wedding band. I don't need that to identify me as a married woman. My moral character, my moral conduct, I'll prove that I'm married and I'm careful. Yes, sir. Oh, how careful we need to be with our influence. Some women, in all probability, have got your jewelry laying around in a jewelry box, and when your children that are not saved will be getting you ready and taking down the garb and the thing to lay you out in your casket, they'll take down your jewelry and they'll take down that brooch for your front, or they'll take down this, and you'll be buried, and the last testimony you'll make to the church people and to your community and to friends and everybody else will be, she didn't give them all up. There she was. She held right on to them. He looked her in the face one morning and he said, wife, don't forget, you promised to go to a breakfast with me, that businessman. She said, that's right. And he said, when you go to that breakfast with me, you're going to have to dress like the rest of the crowd dresses. She said, now, husband, you said I'd made that promise, and I did, and I'll keep that promise, but I'll go to glorify and honor God, or I won't go at all. When she came down the steps that morning, he looked her in the face and said, well, you look like a ghost, no makeup on. And I guess the people will say that I'm just too stingy and too tight to buy you jewelry and that to wear. Well, now she said, I can't help what people say, but she said, if I go with you, this is the way I'm going to appear. I'm going to wield an influence.
He let her out and said, go ahead and find our seat and sit down. He said, I'll get in soon to park the car. He came in and sat down by the side of her. He sat there, sullen grin on his face. When they came in with the breakfast that morning, right away, he said, just a minute, folks. My wife's a Christian, said, I've watched to see if she's going to sprout any wings, but she hadn't sprouted any wings. And said, you know, they look upon us as old heathens, and they pray over their food all the time, and we don't pray. Said, wife, stand and return thanks for us here. Before that society crowd, and she stood to her feet just a few weeks being a Christian. Stood to her feet and thanked God for the privilege and for her husband and for the crowd and for the food. And said, and when she got in the car, she didn't find fault and criticize and fuss on the way home. About 3 months later, he said to her, remember, we're to do for a dinner. And she said, that's right. And they went through the same process. And she came out that morning and he looked upon her and said, you look like a ghost. I'm ashamed of you. I want you to know it. I'm ashamed of you. She said, you may be ashamed of me, but God's not ashamed of me, and I'm living to glorify him. They went through the same process. When they got ready to eat, he jumped to his feet and said, well, his wife said, and I want her to return thanks. We're just like heathens, you know. And she returned thanks again, bowed her head and ate and talked in a congenial way at the table. On the way home, there was no pouting, there was no peace spirit about her. No, sir. Now, how long has it been since you've had a pouting spell and wouldn't talk at the meals and wouldn't talk to anybody else? You had your feelings hurt. You didn't get to have your way. You couldn't do what you plead. That old touchy self-life within.
Amen.
He let her out, took the car around the garage and put it in. Walked in the front door and was taking off his overcoat. And she thought, wonder what now? He reached up and grabbed her by both shoulders and spun her around and looked her in the face. And she saw that tears were running down his face. She said, honey, what is it? He said, you've convinced me this thing is real.
Help.
This thing is real. It's a reality. You've lived it before me. You've made me hungry for it. Oh, thank God, thank God, thank God.
Glory to God.
Our investment, our influence. And the next, I just want to touch one other thought on this point right here. The intensity of my devotion. The intensity of my spiritual life. The intensity of my love for souls. The intensity of this. Let me illustrate this. One of our returned missionaries from India gave this. He was standing there speaking that night, and along the line he was speaking, and then he said, I want to give you an illustration of one of our native pastors and how God has used him and what a power and a witness for God he's been. Said one morning he was dressed and came out from his little old hut, and he was standing there in the mission compound, and some woman walked up from down the street, had a little old bundle wrapped up in her arms, and she walked up to him and said, here's the fruit of your sin, son. And astonished and taken back, he didn't know what it was. He didn't even thank her, he was so taken back. He turned and walked back into his little hut and unwrapped and found a little baby boy dropped into his arms. And the whole town and the whole community, yeah, that's the kind of a life he is. That's the kind of a hypocrite he is. That's the kind of a man he is. Here's the fruit of your sin. He said, Kendall, for 16 long years, that man suffered under that. That man bore under that. That man lived under that. And then after 16 long years and that boy grown, that same woman walked in the little old compound one morning and she said to him, I want to confess my sin. I want to confess my sin. I've watched you rear my boy. I've watched you take care of that baby. I've watched it all. There's something about it. I'm speaking to you, the intensity here. The intensity of this thing. It possesses a spirit, soul, and body. Grips us in a grip that there's no getting away from. I want to confess my sin. That was not your boy. That was not your baby. That was somebody else's baby. I dropped it and laid it in you. I want to ruin you and wreck you and smear you. I want to see if Christianity was real. He said after we listened to the confession and the others in the town had heard it and they went up wailing and screams for the honesty that was proved, this boy is clear. Said he walked back into his little hut and he said, oh God, I don't want to ask you why. But he said, I just want to tell you I don't understand. He said, and God said to me, Rabshakeh,
I didn't have any other way than any other person to trust the boy into the hands of to bring him up for God. So I placed that little boy that wasn't yours in your arms and let you be marked and spoiled and your reputation ruined for you to love and to care and to lead him to God. I had no other way to get him to heaven but by leaving him in your hands and trusting him to your care. Oh, thank God, thank God. Could God do that with Stanley Kendall? Could God do that with you? Is there an intensity of love? Is there an intensity of faith? Is there an intensity of trust? Is there an intensity here of a compassion for a lost and a dying world? Is it there tonight? Or do you and I find there's a reserve and there's a self-protective thing there that cries out and pities and pets and pampers self and doesn't want to go through with it? Doesn't want to go through with it. And I'm closing with this illustration. Back in the Roman Inquisition, back in England, one of our young Catholic boys had prayed through. Of course, when he prayed through, he was cast out as a heretic from the Catholic Church, and they were trying him there before the Inquisition judges, and then finally they condemned him to life imprisonment. He thought, well, that's good. That's better than dying, better than being killed. But there was a reservation. If there's any disobedience whatsoever, he will be killed. They said they put that boy in that prison. First one went down to talk to him as his dad and said, son, you're named after me. You're my firstborn son. We've given you a good home and we've loved you and we've cared. And now you've turned your back on the church. You've turned your back on everything else. You mean you're going to treat dad this way? You mean this is all that your dad's going to get back for all the kindness and all the favors and all that he's done? And that boy stood there and shook under that thing. And finally looked his dad in the face and he said, Dad, I guess that's what I'll have to do. For I found Jesus Christ and I found this so great salvation and peace that I never found back in the old Mother Church. He said, son, I'm sorry you drove a dagger into my heart. It'll cost you, friends, your best friends and some of your family. It'll make it the hardest on you there is. And the church may isolate you. You may live a lonely life. But stay true. Thank God. He's trying the intensity to see if this thing is real. After the father had gone out the next day or two, his mother walked down there and looked him in the face, tears streaming down his face, and said, my boy, I gave you a body. I gave you a name. You've been in our family. I suckered you until you got big enough to eat for yourself. We fed and clothed and schooled you and done all of this. And here's your mother, the mother that loved you and cared. And you're breaking her heart. You've driven yourself away from us and away from the church. Won't you please recant? Won't you please denounce Jesus Christ? Won't you please? And again, that boy stood there shaking under that thing, realizing what it was. And he said, mother, I'm sorry, but I can't. I can't. If I give up Jesus Christ, I give up the hope of eternal life. I give up the hope of heaven. If I give it up, I'm lost and eternally lost. He that will save his life shall lose it. And he that will give his life, thank God, he shall gain it in the world to come. I'm sorry, Mom. And he saw that mother walk out and stagger as she walked with the realization her boy had turned her down. The next one that came in a few days later was his wife and said to him, this is all you think about me. Your marriage vows, all that you took and all that you gave, our home, and I'm your wife, and you and I have been made one, and here you are, you've walked out on us, and here you are, you're in prison, and just because you hold on to Jesus Christ. And she laid every charge there was to lay at that man's feet. But he stood his ground and held his ground, thank God, and did not waver one bit. There was no wavering in him. And then she turned and walked away. And the next day she came back and had her two little children and said, to think of it, here's your two children. They're your own flesh and blood. They're yours. They're mine. They're ours. And here you're leaving them without a daddy. You're leaving them with a home without a daddy. And you're leaving them without a daddy. You're leaving them deserted just to hold on to Jesus Christ. I want to say to you, friend, when the enemy and the world and the flesh gets through tempting and trying, they're going to put every pressure on you and I that they can. And if there's any giveaway, if there's any breakdown, if there's any carnality, if there's any old self on board, if there's any love for the world or the love for money or the love for things or the lust of the flesh or the lust of the eye or the pride of life in there, we're going to break under this thing. The intensity of it. The intensity of this thing that possesses a spirit, soul, and body, that we might be preserved blameless unto the day of the coming of the Son of God. Oh, thank God, thank God. She turned with those children and walked away, and he realized, I'm left alone. I'm left alone. But that man's faithfulness, father's faithfulness, that boy's faithfulness to his mother and his dad and that husband's family and his wife brought revival into that home and reached a whole family for God. Thank God for the faithfulness. Oh, what kind of investment, what kind of an influence, what kind of intensity do we show in this great cause for God? With our heads bowed and our eyes closed, you've been very attentive again tonight. How many in this house tonight would say, Brother Kendall, I'm afraid, and I haven't lived that kind of a life, making that kind of an investment. I'm afraid I haven't wielded that kind of a deep spiritual influence. I'm afraid the intensity of my love and my faith and my devotion and my prayer life and my family altar hasn't been that which would help to bring my whole family in. I'm afraid that some of them might be lost. I'm afraid their blood might be charged to me. I don't want that to happen. I'm not perfectly clear in my heart. I'm not perfectly clear. I'm not clear of a saved experience. I'm not clear of a sanctified experience. I don't know anything about the witness of the Spirit that you talk about. I don't know anything about this. I don't know anything about it. But I want to be included in a closing prayer. While every head's bowed and eyes are closed, are you here tonight? You'll just be downright honest and say, Brother Kendall, I want to be included in the closing prayer tonight, just before we stand for dismissal. God bless you. Others there, just lift up your hand. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I see it, thank you. God bless your heart, I see it, thank you. God bless you, God bless you, thank you, I see it. Others there tonight, you'll just be downright honest in your heart. I'm afraid I've just played church, Brother Kendall. I'm afraid I haven't been as serious. I'm afraid I haven't held this thing as sacred. I'm afraid I haven't been true and loyal and wielded an influence and made the investment and had the intensity of that love that you speak of there tonight. This desperate prophet of God, thank God, that turned Israel back to you. I see it. God bless you, sir. God bless you. Is there another one any place? I see that. Thank you. Thank you. Oh, thank you. I see it. God sees it. If I miss it, God will see it. Are there others any place, upstairs or downstairs, just before we stand for a prayer dismissal? Anyone else, any place, I see it, God bless you. Anyone else, I'm a backslider, I'm away from God, I've known better days, I'm not clear in my sanctified experience, I need help, my family is putting the pressure on me, I need help, some of my family is lost, and I haven't really carried the burden. Any place, anywhere, another hand. All right, let's stand with our heads bowed and our eyes closed.